and welcome to Extra Extra Time. This is like an extra thing that we do after recording the main show, which of course goes out on Wednesday. And this is available on our YouTube channel. Also, if you want to get in touch with the show about Extra Extra Time or about the main show itself, our Twitter account is at @extra_time_show. We're also on Facebook, Extra Time Football Show, and on YouTube, which I guess you'll know about if you're watching this video. And today, the Extra Extra Time show is going to be focused around an issue that we talked about on the main show itself, namely the West Ham situation. Of course, West Ham played Burnley at the weekend and lost 3-0 at the London Stadium. An actually fantastic performance by Burnley, but sadly, no one's talking about that. Everyone seems to be talking on what was going on kind of away from the pitch, or actually on the pitch as well in some situations. But it's all going a little bit wrong at West Ham for many reasons, Kieran.
Yeah, well, I think a lot of it's a bit of fear as well. I mean, they've got this amazing new stadium.
Yeah.
And I think it's the fear that they're gonna go down and it's just going to deteriorate. And I think the frustration from the fans, I mean, they're paying the money to, you know, watch their team every week. And they're just not performing, are they, at all? They've got some good players in the team. They've spent a bit of money. And, yeah, I just think it's fear and frustration from the fans.
Do you think it's to do as well with this mythical West Ham way that they always play this certain type of football and they're not playing it? Do you think it's got anything to do with it? Or
no, I think that's actually a really good point, the aspect of fear, because a lot of people in the media haven't mentioned that. Everyone's really like sort of chiming in on their point of being like, oh yeah, the fans chiming in on this, like they shouldn't be doing this and running onto the pitch and like disrupting the game. I don't think potentially they should have done that, but they've been lied to. That's why the fans are angry. They've been lied to, but there's this aspect of fear that they're in the Olympic Stadium, they're going to go down to the Championship. I would be annoyed if I was paying that much amount of money that you have to pay for a football ticket nowadays. Like, but at the same time, I sort of enjoyed it.
But I mean, Attila, they've got an experienced manager, they've got a stadium which they didn't really have to pay for, which is brand new,
it's got everything.
I know, but it's got everything that he could possibly want in a stadium in regards to
facilities. It's not their stadium. Mm-hmm. They were told, I mean, first of all, this is the parallel with Brighton, and it isn't an exact parallel at all. Yeah. We had our ground that we loved, and it was stolen from us, and we had nowhere to go, and we ended up going to Gillingham. They're in a much better position than that. They had their ground that they loved. I know a lot of West Ham fans. They didn't want to leave Upton Park. They were told they were going to leave Upton Park and they were going to go to this new place. But it wasn't built for them. All the other clubs have stadiums, you know, you have a stadium that's built for your club.
Like Tottenham.
They moved into basically, if you remember our With Dean, where we played for all those years in between,
stadium.
Right? It's like a much, much, much better version of that. But it's not their ground. It's like a second hand. It's like second hand clothes, isn't it? It's like, well, what are we going to do with this? Oh, let West Ham have it. It could have been Orient. I mean, just think about it, you know.
Yeah, it could have been Leighton Orient. You know, they were struggling massively.
But that was, this is the
could
point.
Could have been Spurs.
So there's no.
Yeah, Spurs part.
The first
so
thing
bad,
is a question. Of culture, it's a question of basically feeling that you're in your own place, and they don't. That is not a West Ham type ground. It is not the kind of
It's not an intimate.
It's a great big bowl. It's not a West Ham ground. It could arguably be Arsenal. I mean, or something like that. It is actually a bit reminiscent of the Emirates anyway, really, in terms of the total lack of atmosphere. You actually could actually have books, actually, you know, up there so people could have a read if they wanted to, you know. But there's nothing about West Ham in that. I mean, I was there. We beat them 3-0. They were dreadful. We slaughtered them. It was the most easy. It was the easiest win of the season. They were absolutely awful. There was no atmosphere. I mean, I've been to Upton Park God knows how many times. I mean, in the bad old days, I remember, you know, it was, you know, you had to watch yourself a bit.
But Kieran,
and the problem I just want to say one more thing about this. The problem about it is that they have every right to be angry. They should not be going on the pitch. Obviously, that's stupid. But they must be united. The fans are not united at the moment. There are different fan groups arguing with each other. And there's nasty right-wing politics coming into it too, which should not be there.
We'll look at
that
in a
minute.
They've
got to get united.
Kieran, in terms of new grounds, I mean, obviously Leicester, it's not really a new ground anymore, is it? The King Power, it was the Walkers, but before played at Filbert Street. I mean, as a Leicester fan, do you kind of look back at Filbert Street and kind of get romantic about it, or do you think it's actually for Leicester have done it properly? They've done it well.
Yeah, they have done it well. I mean, it took a while to get that because the atmosphere at the Filbert Street was unreal.
Yeah,
like it's just proper terraces and all that.
Absolutely.
Kind of. But then it took a few seasons to get used to that. You know, it was almost. They called it the Walker's Bowl, I think, to start with.
And oh, the Walker's, yeah.
It was like a bowl with not a lot of atmosphere. I think it took a long time for the fans to get used
bowl
to
of
it.
Crisps.
The players, yeah, a bowl of crisps. But now, I mean, yeah, obviously, gradually, obviously winning the leagues helped.
Yeah,
it's good now.
The
massively.
Atmosphere.
Yeah, first King game this season is great. It's really good.
But Sean, I mean, you're now looking at it from a point of view as someone who is...
Homeless.
Well, yeah, but you've Tottenham. Supposedly the ground is going to be ready for the first game of next season. Mm. I mean, have Tottenham, everything that Tottenham have done in regards to new ground that I've read about, it seems they kind of seem to have done it the right way in the way they haven't really, the fans can still get off at the same tube station, they can still walk the same route. There shouldn't be too much of a difference. The only thing is that the in-ground experience supposedly will now be a little bit better, you'll be able to see better.
Oh, there's going to be a huge difference. This has been, like, Spurs' new stadium has been in the pipeline since 2008. I remember going to White Hart Lane stadium tour with my dad, and they had all the new sort of designs for it, and it looked completely different to what it is now, because obviously the London riots happened, Tottenham was the area where it started, and it's a largely undeveloped sort of area in London. And after the riots, it's called the Northumberland Development Project, where they said that you will have to re-energise, revitalise and pump money into the local community. I suppose we're more than happy to do that. I mean, we obviously try going... I'm so glad we didn't go to Olympic Stadium. We were going to knock the Olympic Stadium down and rebuild it into a football stadium.
I thought there was something that they couldn't do that because they have to keep it as a legacy.
Yeah, exactly that. Spurs, they're rebuilding... White Hart Lane tube station because it's awful right now, and they've completely revived. They've built a university. They've built they're building hotels, shopping centres, like the whole area. I can't wait to go back. I remember going on a train past it, and I don't recognise Tottenham at all. It's fantastic. Spurs have been doing it right, but it's taken such a long time. It's not a thing that you can rush into. Moving to the Olympic Stadium with this sort of idea that this is going to change our team, we're going to be challenging for Europe, we're going to pump all this money in, we're going to get this net spend. They've spent so much money, West Ham, on players, and there's nothing in reward to it.
Gold Sullivan was saying, I think, I can't remember if it was Gold or Sullivan, to be honest, they both just
blur into one, yeah.
But I think it was Sullivan actually said at the weekend that, in fact, the amount of money they make now from the Olympic Stadium extra a year is £8 million. Now, in today's football, rightly or wrongly, £8 million is virtually nothing. And considering they've taken their fans away from a place that they loved, that they identified with, that they called their own, I think fans thought that there was going to be a much larger financial benefit rather than the £8 million.
Yeah. I mean, I really do not understand why they did it, to be honest. I mean, I've been to Upton Park God knows how many times. I've no idea what I've never taken that much interest. Does anyone know why they moved? I mean,
it must be in order to sell the club in the future. The club must be worth so much more.
I think they're playing catch up.
Well, no, it's like, I mean, there's the obvious thing is obviously that the owners of the old ground could then sell the area that it is in for redevelopment, which is always the whole history of our football grounds built in inner city areas.
Well, like Arsenal now,
Highbury is flats now.
Yeah, but I mean, it's what's happening with West Ham is sad, and it's sad because above all, there are small parallels with us, not really, because they were told this stuff and it was all lies. We were lied to, but with us, there was literally nothing. I mean, there was nothing at the end. You know, we ended up playing at Gillingham. Well, but West Ham have gone somewhere which is not theirs, which is soulless. I can't see how you could really make a really good atmosphere in there.
Usain Bolt and Mo Farah stadium than it is West Ham's.
It won't be associated.
It's an athletic stadium. Yeah. It's not a football ground. You know, when you've got that running, I mean, that's the thing. When you have a running track around, I mean, I know this from the Albion. I was the PA announcer with Dean for 14 years. You've got this running track around the pitch, right? So the away end with Dean, I mean, it's ridiculous. Okay, we started off in the fourth division there. We called it the Worthing end because the away fans were so far away from the pitch. I mean, it was ridiculous. I mean, you imagine there was a running track and a hammer throwing area before you actually got to the pitch.
That's why I'm so glad about Spurs that they've made this massive thing about atmosphere in the stadium, and they're trying to make the...
Well, I'm looking forward to going there next season, because I think we will be now. I mean, I think...
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. It's got the largest bar in the world, apparently. It's got its own cheese factory.
It's got some real ale. It's got some craft beer.
Yeah, they've got a lot, but they've made sure that... I mean, what I used to love about White Hart Lane was, I mean, it's a pretty old sort of stadium, but it was classic old, like we were talking about, old Terrace sort of stadium.
Yeah, absolutely.
And... The fans were right on top of the players, and it was such like it would create an atmosphere. And
well, Shelf was great. I mean,
Juventus Stadium, Juventus' stadium. So, from my experience of going to football stadiums in Italy, they've almost all got running tracks around them. So, like
Stadio Olimpico,
Napoli Stadium as well as San Paolo. Yeah. I mean, the Stadio Olimpico is incredible. You're so far away from the pitch, and the atmosphere is great because the Roma fans generate an incredible atmosphere. But you really almost need to be using binoculars when you go there. You're so far away from the pitch. And actually, sometimes you won't see a goal go in. You'll react to the opposite quarter. You'll react to the opposite end. They'll all be celebrating. You'll think, oh, right, we better get on this. Mm-hmm. And then start jumping around. And then the scoreboard will go up. And it's not until you get home, or well, I suppose now you can watch on YouTube, that you can see the goal go in. And that's, it is a problem with the running track. But the last thing I want to discuss very quickly about the West Ham game, I mean, obviously, the situation they're in is not ideal in any way, but the way that the fans chose to show this, to show their dislike for the situation, Sean, I mean, is this in any way acceptable to have people going onto the pitch? I mean, there's the image there of Mark Noble having to wrestle a fan to the ground.
He said in an interview after, he was like, I'm going to protect myself. Like,
yeah,
he's
of course.
More than rightfully, like, in his right to do so.
No, I'm not. The criticism is in no way on Mark Noble. The point is...
Oh, no, I know, but should they be doing that as a protest?
Is this at all acceptable? I mean, especially now, I guess the Premier League are doing more to kind of encourage young people to go to the game or... Just like it's families, boring. This kind of thing. I mean, I read reports. You never know if they're true or not, but you've read reports from parents saying, I had to take my kid out of the stadium because there were fights breaking out and things like this.
See what Burnley did. Some of their players cleared out so they could put young West Ham fans and sit down in the dugout so they wouldn't be near all the fighting. Oh, that's a class touch, but it's scary. I was talking about, like, the elements that are going on in West Ham's sort of fan support base is scary. Mm. Like the fact that we are talking about one of the oldest teams in the country, one of the staple teams in London, having to play games behind closed doors. That shouldn't like
there's,
football
there's,
hooliganism.
There's worrying
well
stuff
past
going
that.
On at West Ham in terms of the right wing element among the older supporters who are basically effectively killing off a united, organised resistance to what the board are doing. Now, and I don't know fully what's going on, but the one thing I would say about this, in terms of direct action, I don't think what happened at West Ham was justifiable at all, because they were basically, you know, they were losing 1-0 to Burnley, they've got a stadium, There are situations, I would certainly not say that it is never acceptable to have direct action. Part of our campaign at Brighton & Albion to save our club was non-violent direct action, and we had to do that. The season before... the last season at the Goldstone, the 1995-96 season, the last game of the season, we stopped the match against York City because we needed everybody around the country to know what was being done to our club. And we knew, because of the Premier League and the fact that everyone's obsessed with the Premier League, that the only way that we would get the attention to Brighton & Albion was by actually physically stopping the game. And we made the decision to do that, and we were absolutely right to do so. We got all the cameras and all the news going to Brighton. They've stopped the match. The match can't continue. Yeah. You know, how disgraceful, hooliganism, blah, blah. And then actually we're saying, no, it's not hooliganism at all. It's loads of people peacefully running on the pitch, making sure they can't go, the game can no longer continue. And that we had to do that. And that was an integral part of the final part of our campaign to save the club. And we're proud of that. I mean, nobody now, none of all the people that were there back then would say that that was the wrong thing to do. There are specific circumstances when it is acceptable.
Yeah.
That was not one of them, and under no circumstances ever should it involve threatening or violence or hostility towards other people.
Well,
and when we did it, it never did. The York City fans at the other end were applauding us, and they came on the pitch and joined with us. You know, they understood completely what was going on. And when the match was replayed behind closed doors, all the York City fans were left in for nothing. Were let in for nothing, and the ones who could make it down at what was it, it was some ridiculous time, a load of Brighton fans stood up and brought them a load of beer. You know, that's what it's about.
Yeah, but that's what it's about. And the whole point of this West Ham is it's divided, isn't it? Yeah. It's so divided.
It's divided and nasty.
So thanks for watching Extra Time. That's the longest we've done yet. Probably the most interesting, actually.
So
like I said, next week we'll be looking back at Manchester United v Brighton. Come on, the Albion, for sure. And we'll also be looking at England for the first time. We haven't really looked at internationals before. We'll be having a look at the international situation 3 months before the World Cup starts, giving some maybe brief predictions about who we think's got a good chance, etc. And also look at England's keeper situation, which is looking pretty tragic at the moment. But we'll go more into depth
Is Harry Kane going to be out for... Because I always said this, there's always some way that England are going to manage to not do very well in the World Cup. We know that.
Oh, yeah.
And this set time, it's got to be because Harry Kane is injured. So
we're
going to
look at that
forever?
Next week. We're
is
be
he
looking...
injured for months? Or
just... I think... Well, I don't think anyone knows about Harry Kane yet.
I think they said that it's not...
I think if there's any doubt, he won't be playing
because
it's a friendly, isn't it? So.
Yeah. I don't think he'll play in the friendlies.
Right, we'll be looking at that next week. So have a nice weekend. Have a nice week and weekend. And see you next week. Okay, goodbye.